What's up, everybody, and welcome in to another edition of the Sitdown. As always, if you enjoy this Saturday video, please make sure you hit the like button and let me know what you think of today's very interesting discussion in the comment section below. If you're new around here, you just haven't done it yet, or you're living under a rock and seeing this video for the first time, I don't know what you're waiting for. Hit that subscribe button below now so you never miss another Sitdown video. Today, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to get in to another very interesting organized crime topic, and one of the most ruthless farm teams in the history of the American Mafia over the last 30 years is a group called the Bath Avenue Crew. Now, I will likely do a full video on the Bath Avenue Crew and its exploits over the years. They were a violent group who sold narcotics, did home invasions, robbed banks, and killed people on behalf of themselves and the mafia. Today, we're going to talk about one of the members of the crew, possibly the most violent. The story of Tommy Reynolds next on the Sitdown. Before we get into the life of Tommy Reynolds, we have to talk about his grandfather and father. If you're going to talk about Tommy, you got to talk about his lineage. And there's a lot of people that don't know Tommy Reynolds' family was quite connected in the mafia. Now, none of them were Italian and none of them were ever made members. But Tommy's grandfather and father, Andrew, were bigwigs in the unions, which made them very important to the mafia. Now, Tommy's father, Andrew, was born in 1949. And he would grow up in Brooklyn, New York. Now, Andrew Reynolds, Tommy Reynolds' father, a person called Thomas Reynolds, was actually someone who maintained a major role as a business agent in the early 70s, and also would become, down the road in the 70s, a trustee in the infamous Teamsters Local 560. Based out of Union City, New Jersey. Now, if you know anything about the story of Jimmy Hoffa, if you've ever seen The Irishman, the local 560 out of New Jersey was run by Anthony Tony Provenzano. That was said that the father of Andrew Reynolds, Thomas Reynolds, was actually married to the sister of Anthony and Nunzio Provenzano. So Tommy Reynolds, the Bath Avenue kid, his grandfather married into the Provenzanos. And like I said, wasn't Italian, but he was given the same respect due to the fact that he was connected in the Provenzano family. Now, Andrew Reynolds would follow his father into local 560, and by the late 60s into the early 70s, would become an agent in the same union, local 560. Now, both Reynolds and his father were obviously closely affiliated with Tony Pro and Nunzio Provenzano, as I said. But they would also become very connected to other members of the Provenzano group, including Steven Andretta and Sally Bugs Brogiulio. Now, if you know anything about the Provenzanos, they would essentially establish something called the Provenzano group that would hold sway over local 560 and make the mafia, mostly the Genovese crime family, a shit ton of money. Now, Tommy Reynolds would ultimately be indicted for being a part of the Provenzano group, but his son, Andrew, would continue the lineage in the union. Now, according to Vincent Fish Cafaro, he would eventually be arrested and would eventually flip, and he would say that on many occasions that, quote, he personally knew Reynolds and stated that Reynolds was one of the individuals that was delivering money to members of the mafia, including Tony Pro Provenzano and others. Now, Fish Cafaro would also say that Reynolds, quote, personally delivered payoff money to Matthew Matty the Horse Aniello, and that the money had been regularly also paid to Provenzano before he was incarcerated. Now, the payoff money was related to an established sweetheart contract between Teamsters Local 560 and a trucking company called Walsh Trucking. So it was said that the go-between between that was Andrew Reynolds, and he was regularly delivering payoff money to Matty the Horse on Yellow. Now, Andrew Reynolds, at one point, would be observed by the FBI leaving the offices in 1980 of Local 560 and driving to the Little Italy area of New York and meeting with people like Bobby Manna and Nunzio Provenzano. Also, on another occasion, according to the same FBI report, Reynolds would visit Anthony Tony Pro Provenzano way out in Lompoc, California, during his incarceration at the facility in the 80s. Then it would also concern another investigation of visitor records in saying that between the time of 1979 and 1982, Reynolds would visit Provenzano up to 10 different times. In addition, in 1984, there was also relations between Andrew Reynolds with people like Matty the Horse, I'm Yellow again. So Andrew Reynolds was very connected. Now, during his life in the late 60s, he would meet a woman called Mary Ann, and they would ultimately have a son. Now, the Reynolds would grow up in the Bath Beach, or come up in the Bensonhurst Bath Beach area of Brooklyn. They would have a son, Thomas Tommy Reynolds, who was born in 1969. Now, Tommy Reynolds would be raised in the heavily Italian area of Bath Avenue in and around Bensonhurst. If you know this area, it has been rife with mob activity for decades. Now, according to the mother of Tommy Reynolds, she would say that at one point, basically, that Tommy Reynolds grew up in very poor situations. According to her, his childhood was, quote, abusive and unhealthy, and that landed him on the streets at a young age. He was also called someone who had no impulsive adolescence, and when he would commit crimes down the road, that was because of it. Ultimately, Reynolds would hit the streets and start running around the area of Bath Avenue in Brooklyn. He would eventually meet multiple young Italian kids, and they would form a group called the Bath Avenue Crew. The crew would consist of Joseph Calco, Fabrizio De Francisi, Paul Galino, and Jimmy Calandra in the Fila sweatsuit. Now, Tommy Reynolds would come up quick. His environment made it simple for him to become what he became, with very little father in his life. Remember, his father, Andrew Reynolds, was moving around in the streets himself and was a criminal. Eventually, his father would move to New Jersey. Now, again, by 1989, Tommy Reynolds is just 20 years old. He would be arrested on two counts of attempted robbery and ultimately get 1 to 3 years in the New York State prison system and was released in 1991. This would begin his delve into criminality. But by this point, he had been very much connected with criminality already. As we know with the Bath Avenue crew, they were doing a lot of orders and favors for people like Anthony Spiro and Joseph Benanti, a capo and soldier in the Bonanno crime family. And as we know from history, that area of Brooklyn, it was impossible, essentially, to go another way, especially when your young kids have very little direction. The call to the streets is all too important. Tommy Reynolds would begin not only selling cocaine and other drugs, but he, alongside other members of the Bath Avenue crew, would be involved in everything from home invasions, robberies, stick-ups, as well as bank robberies. At one point in 1992, Tommy Reynolds, alongside members of the Bath Avenue crew, as well as a person called Chris Paciello, would rob a chemical bank in Staten Island of $300,000. Now, eventually, Tommy Reynolds and the Bath Avenue crew would not only start killing for themselves, but they would also start killing for the mafia. Now, at one point, as we know, in 1991, Anthony Spiro's daughter, Jill, would have her home robbed by a person called Vincent Bickelman. Spiro would order Bickelman be murdered. Members of the Bath Avenue crew would carry out the killing. Now, by 1992, Tommy Reynolds and the crew are making a lot of money. Problem for Reynolds is he starts getting high on his own supply. By the early to mid-90s, Reynolds is a crackhead and a violent drug user. It was also said that Reynolds was, quote, ruthless, and at one point poked someone through the eye with a fork. He would commit beatings, he would shoot people, and he would also murder people as well. Now, for Reynolds, one of the major murders he would be involved in was in 1992 alongside his crew member, Joey Calco. Now, it's unclear exactly why this went on, but after the fact, Reynolds and Calco would kill two individuals in the area of Bay 7th Street and Cropsey Avenue in Brooklyn. Those individuals were multiple members connected to the mafia. Those people were 21-year-old Neil Mastro and his uncle, Vincent DiPippo. Now, after the fact, Reynolds and Calco would claim that they did not know the members that they killed were actually connected to the mafia, and it was likely over some sort of drug beef. Now, in February of 1993, a confidant that they had in Brooklyn and Staten Island called Chris Paciello, who would tell them about heists, would contact Calandra and Reynolds about the possibility of a large sum of money in a home at 95 Mead Loop in Staten Island. According to Paciello, a person called Sammy Shemtov would live there, and he had a safe with hundreds of thousands of dollars in it. Paciello would pass the message to Reynolds and Calandra, and they would plan to rob the home in February of 1993. They would pull up to the home in the area of 95 Mead Loop in Staten Island. During the robbery, the wife of Sammy Shemtov, Judy, would answer the door as her young daughter looked on. In the course of the robbery, Reynolds would shoot Judy Shemtov in the head. Now, according to Reynolds, he would claim that the gun accidentally went off. We can attribute it, though, likely to the fact that Reynolds was high and he killed Judy Shemtov in cold blood. She was absolutely innocent and died at the hands of a violent, drug-addicted, depraved lunatic. Shemtov will be shot multiple times. Now, the killing would not stop for Tommy Reynolds. He was a nut, quite honestly, and the Bath Avenue crew were nuts. One of the members of the crew, Paul Galino, was getting in over his head. He believed by this point that all the things he had done, he should become a made member of the mafia. Now, they were also involved, the Bath Avenue crew, in a war with a group called the 20th Avenue crew, and things were going on. They needed people like Anthony Spiro to talk on their own behalf. Keep in mind, he was one of the more powerful people in the Bonanno crime family. Now, I did a video on Anthony Spiro that can be seen here if you'd like to see it. Now, in 1993, in and around July of that year, Spiro is approached by Paul Galino because Galino is upset. During the course of a conversation on a Brooklyn street in July of 1993, Paul Galino would shove Spiro, which was an absolute no-no. As an associate of the mafia, you never put your hands on a made member, let alone a capo regime. Anthony Spiro would order the murder of Paul Galino. Now, according to Joseph Calco, he would eventually cooperate. He would say that Joseph Benanti, a soldier of Anthony Spiro, would allegedly tell Calco, quote, "Paulie's got to go. He's got to be killed. That's what the old man wants. He's got to go this day." Now, Joseph Benanti would act essentially as a messenger, but he was a 1-2 kind of protege of Anthony Spiro, and the old man was Anthony Spiro. Calco would then say that he and Reynolds would go to the home of Paul Galino. He would then ask Galino for something to drink as they followed him into the kitchen. Calco would then say, quote, "I walked behind him, pulled out my gun, and shot him in the back of the head." He fell to the floor. I went up to him, put the gun to the side of his head, and shot him again. So Reynolds was not the trigger man, but he was there, which would mean it was another murder for Thomas Reynolds. Keep in mind and understand what I'm saying. These kids have been friends since they were kids. But Anthony Spiro knew when someone had to go in that crew, it wasn't some random hitman that was going to kill Paul Galino. He was too sharp for that. It would have to be the friends of Paul Galino, Tommy Reynolds and Joey Calco. Tommy Reynolds and the Bath Avenue crew were a complete mess. They were killing each other. Several were already being arrested and heading off to prison. And Tommy Reynolds had to live with the fact that his criminality was eventually going to catch up with him. In the late 90s, he would be arrested for unspecified crimes. And by the early 2000s, alongside Anthony Spiro, Joseph Benanti, and Fabrizio De Francisi, Tommy Reynolds would be indicted on racketeering and ultimately murder charges, not only in the murders of Neil Mastro and Vincent DiPippo, but in the very sad murder of Judith Shemtov. Now, eventually, Tommy Reynolds would plead guilty and ultimately be sentenced to life in prison. However, the life in prison charge or conviction, the sentence was allowed to be withdrawn after it was disclosed that a case manager had told Tommy Reynolds that he would get a break in sentencing in exchange for a guilty plea. Ultimately, the judge in the case of Tommy Reynolds would hit Reynolds with 42 years in federal prison. During the sentence, Tommy Reynolds' mother would say, quote, screaming, "If Tommy would have been an informant, maybe he would have gotten 6 or 7 years. That's my only son. Nobody cares about me." She would also say at one point to the judge, quote, "42 years? What is that going to do?" She would then ask the judge to speak, to which the judge would say no. And Mary Ann Reynolds would say again, quote, "Are you happy now?" Addressing the victim's daughter, "You can go home and be happy." This is an absolutely cold and callous thing to say to a young woman who your son violently killed. Keep in mind, Marianne Reynolds is upset at the daughter of Judith Shemtov because her son was given 42 years for cold-bloodedly killing her mother. Now, we can understand that Marianne Reynolds was overcome with grief and her only son was going to prison probably for the rest of her life. She may never see her son again. But this is the cold reality of what happens to people that violently kill people in society. Now, Tommy Reynolds ultimately, though, had light at the end of the tunnel. At one point, a judge would essentially say that there will be light at the end of your tunnel after he pled guilty. Now, Reynolds has been in prison since the early 2000s after he was sentenced in 2004. Many photos have come out of him in prison, including this one of Reynolds on the right with his old crew member, Fabrizio De Francisi. Now, other members of the crew, including Jimmy Calandra and Joey Calco, would all cooperate with the federal government. Calandra is currently on YouTube telling stories, and Joe Calco lives in Florida. He had been arrested several years ago in a bizarre assault at a pizzeria he ran in Florida. Now, for Reynolds, I want to kind of talk about his prison life because according to him and his family in a plea for compassionate release, they would say that Reynolds is a completely changed man. Now, Reynolds' godmother during a compassionate plea would explain in a letter that the lowest point of Reynolds' incarceration would come in 2013 when his father, Andrew Reynolds, would die. She would say that, quote, "Reynolds discovered God, and this new and yet abiding faith precipitated a radical change in all aspects of his being." Now, according to prison records, it has been said that Reynolds has taken at least 52 courses since 2008. And according to his godmother, he has so excelled in the Alternatives to Violence class series that he was asked to teach several sessions of the program by the course instructors. Today, Reynolds spends his days productively serving as lieutenants and captains orderly, a job given to only two inmates in the prison, devoting time to Bible study, exercising, and taking educational and vocational courses. Now, according to two people that I've had on this show, Robert Rosso and Chad Marks, who both knew Tommy Reynolds in prison, they would say that he is essentially a different person and that all the things that have been said about him are absolutely true. In fact, Chad Marks would actually help Tommy Reynolds in the compassionate release and sentence reduction that I'm about to talk about. Now, also speaking up for Reynolds came from other inmates. According to another inmate in prison with Reynolds at FCI Raybrook, he would say, quote, "Tommy came to my rescue. He literally guided me on how not to be my own worst problem. Because of his love and support, I've been able to maintain sobriety and accomplish many things, such as completing an apprenticeship program and graduating from college," writes another. Now, one of the correctional officers, a senior officer called Officer Cully at FCI Raybrook, would describe Reynolds as, quote, "respectful, obedient, and always willing to lend a hand to either officers and put other inmates first instead of himself." So we can probably argue that multiple people, not just his family, have compelled that he is a changed man. Understand, he has been in prison nearly 20 years and has spent most of his life inside. Now, Reynolds himself would even comment on his fate in a handwritten letter to the courts. He would say, quote, "To the courts and all the people I have hurt, both mentally and physically, I am truly sorry for the person I was and the way I lived until about 10 years ago. I'm sure this was my life. I lived a meaningless life that amounts to nothing. I am not proud of the person I was. I wish I could go back and change everything. I would first like the Shemtal family to know how truly sorry I am. And I've tried to do that over the years, hoping maybe they would help them to know that I never wanted this to happen. And like many other things in my life, I cannot change, but I am sorry with all my heart." I want to make it clear, all of the crimes Tommy Reynolds committed were essentially before and right around the age of 25. I am not making excuses for a grown adult who willingly killed people in cold blood, sold drugs, committed bank robberies, and home invasions. But I will say, Tommy Reynolds is now in his 50s. Do I think he is the same person? No. I think people can undergo incredible change over the years, and many people, dozens of people, have wrote compelling testimonials that he is a changed man. Do I feel bad for Tommy Reynolds? A bit. But we have to also remember he is a cold-blooded killer who didn't kill just one person. It's likely that he killed multiple people, even his friends. In May of 2022, Tommy Reynolds would get a 6-year sentence reduction in his case. His projected release date is January of 2030. He currently sits at FCI Otisville, not far from his old Brooklyn neighborhood. At least his mother can go see him. Tommy Reynolds is currently 54 years old. I want to leave you with this. This is something that Tommy Reynolds' mother would say to me in a YouTube comment from something she would say on a video I did about a year ago. She would tell me, quote, "I've been waiting for the day he comes home because until that happens, my life is incomplete. He is my world and my life, and there's a soft side to him not everyone knows. I wanted to thank you for not saying anything bad about him because it's hurtful. And he will always be my baby." A mother will always love her kid. And we cannot, knock Marianne Reynolds for that. We would hope that she gets to see her son again. I know Judy Shemtov can't see her son or daughter again. I'm just trying to speak in generalities. I think Tommy Reynolds has paid for his crimes. And according to her, to other people that I've spoke to, the goal for Reynolds is to leave the area and go up to the New England area and just live a regular life. As long as he does not pass away, Tommy Reynolds will see the streets again. It's likely we'll probably never hear his name after that. Tommy Reynolds is a violent psychopath who killed people. But he's just another name in the many that delved into the farm team lifestyle of the mafia. The Bath Avenue crew all had different endings, but they still are some of the more compelling people in the farm team history of the mafia. We'll see you next week here on The Sitdown.